This is Gilbert Gottfried, and I'm here with Frank Santopadre, and this is... What did I do?
It's good. Keep going.
And this is Gilbert Gottfried's Amazing Colossal Podcast.
That's
Paul
it.
Raybone.
Paul Raybone.
Raybone, the jazz musician.
You don't have to call me Ray.
Paul Raybone.
You're in luck because I brought my Raybone with me, and I'm going to play it later in the show.
Wow.
Okay, I see where we're up.
Paul Raybone.
Raybone.
My professional name from here on out.
They had Come and Get Your Love was their big hit. Raybone. Remember them? Hey.
It's his gay porn name.
It is. We are doing, our fans by our fans insist on it, our 2017 In Memoriam episode.
This begins with people we wish had died.
These are people. Although Gilbert is being overcome with consumption, sitting about a foot away from me, so he may be the last name read. We're going to. We've done a couple of these now.
Yeah.
This is our third one. There's our second one with Paul. The first one we did at Gilbert's kitchen table, and the listeners responded to them. So you know, a show like this that pays tribute to the past, it's only fitting. So we're going to go through some of our favorite people that we lost during the year. And Paul has some, believe it or not, Gil, some vital research.
Oh, okay.
vital is the key.
Well, he has some tidbits.
We're going back a year, so I'm starting in January.
I started him on this, yeah. I started him back on last New Year's. I started him on this, predicting who we would lose. Let's start with our favorite... and we'll try to keep this as reverent as possible with Gilbert in the room. You know that can be difficult. I urge you to check out the episode that we did paying tribute to who was it now?
Musicians.
Well, David Cassidy for one.
Oh, yes.
But that's not even what I'm referring to. There was one, and I'll think of it. But there was one episode where we did a tribute episode, and oh boy. Anyway, let's start with character actors.
Yes.
And we love to talk about character actors on this show. We lost Benson, Robert Guillaume.
Oh, yeah.
At the age of 89 recently. Had you ever met him in your travels?
No, never met
Robert
Guillaume.
All the sitcoms you did?
Yeah, never met him. I know he was one of those people, like, I think it became overboard with him, where he felt really responsible, you know, that he was a black person.
Yes, and I found that in the research.
Had to keep the image. And I think he went a little, you know, like a little much with it. Like, he didn't like Rochester on the Jack Benny show.
Yeah, well, it's kind of why he was perfect to play that part, because that was the polar opposite of a Step and Fetch It character. He was also a song and dance man. I don't know what you found about him, Paul, but he grew up in the St. Louis slums, grew up without plumbing, without electricity, and it was a hard scrabble life. And he was the first Nathan Detroit in the first black version of Guys and Dolls, which I found interesting. He also was the first African-American to sing the title role of Andrew Lloyd Webber's Phantom of the Opera. Did you find
that? I had no idea that he was a musical guy.
I had no idea that he was a musical guy. Yeah. That's odd. You find things out about these people when they pass.
And
that's right.
I was reading some directors said on Benson, they're all supposed to be sitting around the breakfast table.
Benson Dubois. So,
yeah, and they had like plates with pancakes in it. And he took offense to that.
Did he?
Yeah.
That's interesting. You have to send me that.
Yeah, he said... this is like Uncle Ben.
Interesting. So he was very sensitive about stereotyping. Great in a short-lived Aaron Sorkin show called Sports Night. Great in bit parts on A Doctor on All in the Family comes to mind. Very funny. And really, he stole that show, that show Soap, which was a well-written show and an ensemble cast, and he stood out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Which was a credit to his talent. And I found out he was a folkie. Did you find that?
Folk singer?
He was a folk singer with a group called the Pilgrims.
Boy, it's funny, these guys
had no idea.
How do you transition from that?
I don't know. He was a multi-talent, and he never sat on his balls like Mr. Belvedere. So we'll give him that.
Well, it's try it if you've never done it.
Here's a name. Here are two names, and I found this interesting because people confuse them because their names were alike. Two great character actors, John Hurt. The Elephant Man, the British actor,
yes,
passed away. And also John Hurd,
yeah,
passed away in the same year, a couple of months apart, which I found odd. But last year, the guy that played Kato from the Panther films died, and the Green Hornet died.
Oh,
so there's
wow.
the Green Hornet and Kato. But
wow.
John Hurt, Midnight Express, a movie that's come
yes,
up on this
yes.
show. Of course, the famous chest burster scene in Alien. He was also known for, but do you remember him as Jesus in Mel Brooks' History of the World?
No.
When they're all posing for the Last Supper, and I think Art Mitrano is the photographer.
Oh, my God.
Or is playing Da Vinci. Yeah.
So he was, I didn't know much about him, but he also hung around with Oliver Reed, Peter O'Toole, Richard Harris.
Oh, I mean, yeah. This was the heavy drinker,
kind of
the heavy drinking
boys,
crowd.
Bad boys gang.
Yeah, yeah. yeah, he's also great in a picture called V for Vendetta. But a Shakespearean actor trained
did,
at.
Did you mention? I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
A Man for All Seasons. Which
yes.
is one of my favorite.
Yes.
movies, Paul Scofield.
And
yes.
He did some weird, unfunny comedy with Ryan O'Neal
called Partners.
Yeah.
I believe, and he was a gay cop.
Yes.
Yeah, it was tone deaf.
Yes.
As I recall, boy,
yeah.
the things you
when,
remember.
Oh,
when,
yeah.
when would that have been roughly?
80s.
80s.
Early
yeah.
80s, maybe.
He was tough as nails and a ladies' man. And his partner's gay.
You know, according to this, Gilbert, he was in Thumbelina.
Oh, my God.
Well, everybody was in Thumbelina.
Boy, so I worked with him and Gino Conforti.
I think so, and, unless it's a different version of Thumbelina.
And none of you remember it.
Because he did voice work for things like Watership Down and Thumbelina. He was knighted in 2015. And he's very, very good in a Death in Venice knockoff called Love and Death on Long Island that people should see. But his career performance is in The Elephant Man. Is
oh,
in,
yeah.
Is in Lynch's Elephant Man. He's magnificent.
And another bad movie I remember him in.
You're just going to pick all the clunkers
yes.
yeah.
as we pay
this
tribute to the man.
The poor guy
movie
is dead.
with Judd Nelson.
Wow, you've stumped me.
Judd Nelson is like this edgy, wild lawyer.
Oh, I remember this movie.
Like something like Stormy Days.
Stormy Monday or something?
Something like that, a pun.
I know, that's it.
Stormy Weather, I maybe.
Well, we'll have Paul look it up.
And Raybone will look
Raybone.
It up.
Raybone.
And it's like John Hurd is a brilliant but crazed killer.
I don't remember this picture at
what
all.
What do we think? It might be Stormy Weather or something?
I don't know. Just look up John Hurt, H-U-R-T, and Judd Nelson.
Yeah.
Two Ds.
Not a good movie.
People, if you haven't seen The Elephant Man, I never had the pleasure of seeing it on Broadway, but that film, that Lynch film, produced by Mel Brooks.
Oh, yes.
Of all people, is just a performance that will...
I'm not an animal. I'm a human being.
That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
You never got an audition?
Yeah, so we'll have to.
Gilbert Gottfried is the Elephant John Merrick. Wow, I'd like to live to see that. While he's looking that movie up, I'm going to bring up John Hurd, another guy who left us too soon. What wasn't this guy in? The Pelican Brief, Cat People, with Nastasia Kinski, Big. Awakenings with Robin Williams.
Yeah.
Of course, the Home Alone pictures where he was the dad. A great movie called Cutter's Way with Jeff Bridges.
Oh, yeah.
Who you guys need to see that one. I'm going to throw a lot of film
recommendations. He was in Big.
He wasn't Big. I said that.
As the pissy. I'm sorry.
I just said that. Yeah. Raybone.
Well, I was looking up the other one.
Chilly Scenes of Winter. Another good picture with him and Mary Beth Hurt. No relation. Great as a corrupt detective on The Sopranos. He did everything. 105 films and 67 TV series.
Jesus.
John Hurd. Yeah, a real working actor. And I think the last thing he may have done was appearing on Ileana's podcast. And there was actually a bittersweet story. She had to convince him to do the show, and he kept saying, nobody wants to hear from me. Nobody knows who I am.
Wow.
And she finally convinced him to do it, and he did it, and he had a good time, and he passed away a couple of days later. And an actor I always love seeing at things, and he's in my beloved After Hours, Scorsese's picture. Which
so I got some good stuff on John Hurt. Gilbert is partly right. He's always got part of these things.
What is it called?
The movie's called From the Hip.
From the Hip.
Okay.
That was Stormy Weather?
But wait, no, wait. Here's the kicker. The lead character played by Judd Nelson is Robin Stormy Weathers.
Incredible. Stormy
you
Weathers.
Are a savant.
Robin Stormy
if
Weathers.
Ever I met one. That's a nice piece
that's
of work.
That's a good one, isn't it?
And their big trick, I'm a spoiler now, to prove, I don't know, to make him angry. You know, because he has to defend him, but he doesn't want to defend someone guilty. So he starts yelling out that John Hurt couldn't get an erection. And that makes him... It's as bad a movie. The way I'm describing it is a better movie.
You can do a tribute show like nobody's business. Okay.
He's defending a guy.
So the takeaway is do not see From the Hip and Partners, but do see The Elephant Man and Love and Death on Long Island.
But the one thing that might want to have you take a look at From the Hip is the defendant here in one of these cases is a professor accused of killing a prostitute with a hammer.
Oh, nice. That's it.
Yeah. Nice
you
stuff.
Don't see that every day.
Yeah.
Nice stuff. Let me forge ahead here with some of our favorite character actors. And this
next one was in gay porn.
No.
I'm just jumping ahead.
This gentleman died far too soon. This is the late Bill Paxton.
Yes.
61, and that was sudden and unsurprising. And apparently he'd had difficulties since he was a child. Had some rheumatic fever that weakened his heart, which I think was the same situation with Bobby Darin. If I'm not mistaken.
Oh, my God, yeah.
From Fort Worth, another musician had a new wave band called Martini Ranch. I love that. As I said, you research these guys and you find all the cool stuff.
Yeah.
And he remained very young looking.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, James Cameron directed him in a music video for his band, and that's how they forged a relationship.
Oh, so geez.
And then 2 years later, he cast him in Terminator and then Aliens, and
he became
make
like
him a star.
A James Cameron theater company of one.
Oh my God!
Paxton with Terminator, Aliens, True
and
Lies,
Aliens, and True. Right, is he in True Lies? I guess he is.
I think he's,
Titanic.
You mentioned
Titanic, of course.
He's a scientist,
of course,
and Big Love, which is not James Cameron.
Big Love,
great show,
terrific show. I love him in a movie called One False Move, which is a thriller that people should see. Apollo 13, of course, Tombstone, and a movie you like and have talked about, A Simple Plan.
Very good movie.
Yeah. Sam Raimi.
Yeah, that was one of those movies that, you know, is one of those, like, it goes back to that, you know, Treasure of Sierra Madre.
Absolutely.
Premise.
Absolutely.
Of, like, people who get wealth. And then it drives them out of their minds.
Yes, it's a greed. It's a movie about greed and bringing people down.
And it builds and builds, and everything that can go wrong is going wrong.
Terrific picture.
And
Billy Bob Thornton.
Billy Bob Thornton and Bridget Fonda.
Bill Paxton. See that one. I had the honor of
interviewing. Oh, and Gary Cole, I think.
Correct.
Yeah.
I had the honor of interviewing him a couple of years ago. He directed a movie called The Greatest Game Ever Played, and the Writers Guild asked me to interview him, and he could not have been cooler.
Yeah.
He really was fun and sweet, and there was not a bit of pretense about him. He waved to JFK in the motorcade as a kid in Dallas.
Oh, wow.
Isn't that fun trivia? Yeah. A very, very lovely guy, and the Storm Chasers pay tribute to him.
Because
he was in Twister.
Right.
Oh,
when he passed away. Yeah.
We had talked about this ahead of time. They have a storm tracker website that they use to track storms in Oklahoma. Yeah.
Correct.
And also the storm chasers. And so a bunch of these guys went out to various locations in this area, turned on their GPS. So you get the little dot that shows where you are on the map. And they all arranged themselves a certain way that they got BP.
They spelled his name.
His
initials.
Wow.
One of the guys said it was just we just had to do it because it was the only time that storm trackers were ever seen as cool.
Yeah, that's a sweet tribute.
Wow. It was very nice.
It's a sudden. I mean, a great actor, a versatile actor, and 61 too soon. Here's two Brooklyn boys and two favorites of Gilbert's right here that we lost this year, both in their 80s. Joe Bologna.
Oh, yeah.
Who we wanted on this show.
Yes.
And we talked about him, and we talked about him with Norman, and we talked about him with Bill Macy. And he'd been sick for a long time. Married his longtime spouse, Renee Taylor, on the Merv Griffin Show.
Oh,
was
wow.
It? I saw the web, it said on the stage of the show. Was it actually the during of the show?
Well, now I could be wrong. But I don't think it was on the air. I think it was on the stage. Interesting guy. Started his own ad agency. Won Clio Awards.
Oh.
He was an ad man. Did you know that?
Wow.
Like Dave Thomas.
Before he got into
yeah.
acting? That was...
Yeah.
Now, a bad show. Actually, a bad attempt at a spinoff.
Oh, he was in the Married with Children spinoff.
Yes,
that's
yes.
right. With Matt LeBlanc?
Matt LeBlanc.
Boy.
Whatever Gilbert, happened to him?
Gilbert's contribution is he's going to find yes. all the turkeys.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And it was one of those, Married with Children would do that a lot, where they try a spinoff where Al would say, hey, it's my best friend, so yeah. and you go, if it's his best friend, how come we've never heard of him before? Right.
You know who was one of his best friends in the business? Was Art Matrano. He directed Art's one-man show, and he was the guy that gave Art the title, Jews Do Not Belong on Ladders.
Wow.
Which Art was here telling us about just a couple of weeks ago.
Wow.
He and Renee, his wife, who's still with us, great character actress, wrote Lovers and Other Strangers.
Yes.
Which is a scream. And the doctors who were treating him for cancer kept him alive long enough so that he could attend the 35th anniversary screening of My Favorite Year.
Oh,
which is
wow.
so sweet, which he's yeah. in the Sid Caesar part, yeah. right. King Kaiser. Right. And he's absolutely wonderful. And Dick Gutman, our friend Dick Gutman, is his publicist, and we were working on it. I guess he wasn't well enough to do it.
Yeah.
So that was a big loss for us. And this one, too. Some of these people really sting because we really wanted them desperately. And for whatever reason, we couldn't make it happen, and that's Martin Landau.
Yeah, we really wanted to talk to Martin Landau.
We tried like crazy. Maron got him, damn it. And that's a good show. It's a good episode that Mark Maron did
yeah,
with him.
Yeah, because he would have had so much to talk about.
Brooklyn kid and a cartoonist for the Daily News.
And a particular interest to Gilbert in Ed Wood. He played the supporting role of Bela Lugosi.
Of course.
Oh, yeah.
Of course, he won the Oscar for it.
Won the Academy Award, right.
Yeah.
And Mission Impossible.
He was great in Mission
yeah.
Impossible.
Yeah, Roland Hand.
Stoic, you know.
Yes.
Oh, with Alfred Hitchcock. Was that?
Oh, it was, yes. He played James Mason's gay henchman. In
North by Northwest.
In North by Northwest. Yeah. That was the thing that got him noticed.
And I heard that when he was making North by Northwest, he asked Hitchcock, he said, why did you hire me? What made you hire me? And because he saw him in a play where he hardly spoke at all. And Hitchcock said to him, because there's a circus going on in your head.
Oh, I love that. I never heard that.
Yeah.
He turned down a promotion at the Daily News. He was a successful cartoonist, but he wanted to act. And so he auditioned and for Actors Studio, and he told the story that only he and Steve McQueen, they were two of 2,000 applicants that actually got in.
Boy, yeah.
Can you imagine?
Just hearing this, it just is a further kick.
I know. Doing the research, it killed me. I said to my wife, I do not want to research Martin Landau because I'm going to just sit here and I'm going to have a pain in my stomach.
Because we were trying for him.
Dick Gutman, again, was really trying for Martin, and we sent dates. I mean, it was close, and it just, and then he just,
just
suddenly took a turn for the worst. He had a dry spell in his career, a big dry spell. He wound up doing things like slumming on things like Harlem Globetrotters on Gilligan's Island. But bounced back.
Baps.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Real low points, but pushed through and made a comeback with Tucker.
Yes.
The American Dream, Crimes and Misdemeanors.
Oh, he was terrific.
Absolutely
in that.
Wonderful. And of course, Ed Wood, written by our pals, Scott and Larry.
He's just got great presence. I don't know if that's another way of saying what Hitchcock said, but
one of my favorites.
He just kind of fills a room.
In
you know?
Crimes and Misdemeanors, which is a part with a sympathetic killer.
Yes, yes, a wonderful movie. Yeah.
That's not an easy thing to pull off.
He was great in that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Here's another guy, no less memorable, different kind of character actor. You brought up Big Love before, who we lost this year. At 91, Harry Dean Stanton.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
How about, can we just have a moment of silence and say Paris, Texas?
Paris, Texas, yes. That is one of my favorite movies of the 80s.
Yeah, that's a great movie.
And that was and at 58, he talked about how Paris, Texas put him on the map.
Oh, yeah.
And he'd been acting.
At 58, yeah.
He'd been acting. He's in The Godfather 2, I guess. He's one of the FBI guys that's guarding Frankie Pantangeli.
Yes.
But he was in everything. Yeah. He worked with Hitchcock. He was in Inner Sanctum. He was in Suspicion, a series directed by Hitchcock called Suspicion. He's in Kelly's Heroes.
And
he's in Tulane Blacktop.
Was he ever young?
I don't think so. We talk about John Hurt. He's also an alien. He's one of the.
That's right.
He's one of the crew in Alien. And
he's. I had one interesting tidbit here. He was in Cool Hand Luke.
Yes, he's in Cool Hand Luke.
And he taught Paul Newman to sing. I don't care if it rains or freezes as long as I got my plastic Jesus.
Wow.
He was working for years before anybody. And then Repo Man.
Repo Man,
Paris, Texas and Repo Man.
Yeah.
Oh, this guy. And then Pretty in Pink.
Yeah.
And then Wild at Heart. And then he was suddenly a star.
Yeah.
After.
He was one of those guys that had kind of America or the West just written all over his face.
Yes.
You know? I mean, he just,
absolutely.
A million lines in his face.
Yeah.
And he was great.
Apparently close friends with Nicholson. He was best man at Jack Nicholson's 1962 wedding, and they lived together for 2 years after Nicholson's divorce. Now, there's an odd couple.
That's pretty close friends, I guess.
Imagine doing the odd, going to see the odd couple with Jack Nicholson and Harry Dean Stanton. Another guy who had his own band. Harry Dean Stanton and the Repo Men. And they sang at Hunter Thompson's funeral.
Or
Harry did. I don't know if the band was there, but this is the kind of stuff you find.
Yeah.
Bill Paxton had a band.
Yeah.
Robert Guillaume had a band. You know, these musicians, these guys that are kind of doing double duty.
Yeah.
Anyway, great character actors who really, really left their mark. And here's a couple of others. A short list of wonderful faces and people we wished we'd gotten on the show. Chuck Lowe. Do you know that name? Chuck Lowe was Maury in Goodfellas.
Oh, my God.
A local guy, New York guy. He's in The King of Comedy. He's the guy making the faces in the background. So Scorsese must have been a friend or used him several times. Found in my research that he played in Goodfellas. The character Maury was based on a guy named Martin Krugman, who did own a wig shop, was involved with the Lufthansa heist, and his body was never found.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Isn't that interesting?
Stranger than fiction.
And speaking of Scorsese and tough guy character actors, Frank Vincent passed away.
Oh, yes.
Who this year?
Frank Vincent, another one I would have loved to. There's that one line in Goodfellas.
Yep.
Where, he's pissing off Pesci at the bar.
Billy Batts.
And then he goes, I'm just having fun with you.
I'm just breaking your balls.
Yeah, I'm breaking your balls. And then before he takes a shot, he's got the shot glass up, and right before he takes the shot, he goes, now go get your fucking shine box.
Brilliant. He's brilliant in that movie. Well, of course, Pesci beats the shit out of him in Raging Bull, too.
Yes.
Because he's Salvi, and he hits him in the head with the metal pole. He was Pesci's friend from childhood. He was Pesci's friend forever. Frank Vincent.
Yeah.
And
They used to call him Spit Shine Johnny.
Yeah, make you shine like fucking mirrors.
Was he Italian? Frank Vincent sounds like one of those.
Yes, he was Italian.
Yeah.
And speaking of Raging Bull, LaMotta himself passed away this year, too.
Oh, yeah.
Jake LaMotta. But Chuck Lowe and Frank Vincent, two guys from Goodfellas, two memorable faces, and just memorable New York actors.
And I remember that in the movie, like, what am I, a schmuck? What am I?
Schmuck on wheels?
Yeah. I want my money.
He's great in that performance.
Yeah. Give me my money.
Yeah. Maury. John Hillerman, going all the way from New York to Texas.
Oh, yes.
Another guy we chased. John Hillerman.
And John Hillerman's one of those people, born again as an Englishman.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Yes. And was he ever young? Like Harry Dean Stanton.
Never.
John Hillerman, Blazing Saddles and Paper Moon. And
it's kind of like how Jonathan Harris.
Yes.
Was, you know, Jew from Brooklyn.
Yes.
But he became an English Shakespearean actor.
John Hillerman was just a character actor you just loved seeing. You knew he was going to class up everything. I think he's in What's Up, Doc. I think we asked Prognanovich about him when we had him here.
Yeah.
Paper Moon.
Billions.
So good. Would have loved to have gotten him. Obviously, we say all the time on the show, we can't get everybody.
Yeah.
And here's another guy we didn't get, and that was Richard Anderson from the $6 Million Man and the Bionic Woman. You know that actor? Died at 91. Oscar Goldman, who was also in Paths of Glory, who had an acting career that 7 days in May. And, of course, he got an action figure, the Oscar Goldman action figure in the 40-year-old Virgin.
You guys are... I got at least half these people you're talking about, I've never
You know
heard
this
of.
Actor. You ever seen the $6 Million Man?
Yeah.
He was the contact, the big man, the guy that oversaw everything. Oscar Goldman.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah, but he's in a million things.
Yeah.
Michael Parks from Then Came Bronson.
Oh my God.
Remember Michael Parks?
Oh, absolutely.
We saw him at Chiller Fest
a couple of years ago. He was one of those, you know, James Dean.
James Dean types.
Actors.
Yeah, bad boy. Yeah, James Dean type. Like a poor man's Dennis Hopper.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Then Came Bronson, I think, was an Easy Rider.
Yeah, that's when they were all wanted the next fugitive.
Yes, yes. And great in Twin Peaks, the original version of Twin Peaks as a sleazy villain.
I remember a Chiller. He was already looking.
Good actor, though.
Who was he in Twin Peaks?
Very he was actor. Jean Reno.
Jean Reno.
Yes.
One-Eyed Jax.
He was the guy with the knife under his sleeve. Rich is a great villain. Glenn Headley. Glenn Headley. The late wife. She was married to John Malkovich. And she was one of the founders of Steppenwolf, the theater company in Chicago. You know Glenn.
Oh, okay.
Glenn, am I saying her name right? Is it Glenn Headley or Glenn Headley? I think it's Glenn Headley. But look that up. I've never actually had to say it before or hear it. Dirty Rotten Scoundrels.
Oh, okay.
She was Tess Trueheart and Dick Tracy.
Yeah. Oh, all right.
You know the actress I'm talking about.
Yes, yes.
She was in a lot of stuff. Died young, 62. I hope I'm saying her name right. And since I'm not that far removed from bringing up Twin Peaks, I'd like to bring up Miguel Ferrer, who we lost.
Oh, yes.
Jose Ferrer's son and a really close friend of Richard Kind's, our friend Richard Kind. Terrific actor. RoboCop.
And he worked like crazy. Worked
in everything. He was a beloved guy. He was apparently also the son of Rosemary Clooney.
Oh, yes.
And so he was show business royalty. A wonderful actor. For us Peaks fans, he was just memorable.
And
the best thing about that show, Albert Rosenfield.
And since I'm here to bring up bad things, every one of our
You got a bad Miguel Ferrer movie?
Blank Check.
Yep, I know that one. He was going for the check.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
But he was terrific.
Terrific in everything he did and funny.
Yes.
And edgy and funny in RoboCop. Playing a sleazebag but doing it with a wink.
Oh, yeah.
And the same thing on Twin Peaks. He played a good guy, but he was a major asshole. Here's one. Did I get the spelling, the pronunciation of Glenn Headley right? Or does it not have
it's
that?
It's H-E-A-D-L-E-Y.
Yeah.
So it could be either
it
way.
It could be either way. But our listeners will tear me a new one about it. Mike Connors died. Mannix.
Oh, wow.
He was 91. Mannix. We called him when we first started this show. Dara called him up, and he said he was having back surgery.
Oh.
And he never got back to us. And we followed up, and I don't know what the hell happened. But it would have been fun to have Mannix. Here's an actor I think you liked, Gilbert, and he did a lot of things. Powers Booth.
Oh, I did like Powers Booth. He did this movie, Southern Comfort.
Oh, good movie. Walter Hill.
Yeah, and it was similar to Deliverance, but boy, it's a really strange film.
Yeah. He did a lot of good work. He won an Emmy for playing Jim Jones.
Oh, he
was. The Reverend Jim Jones.
He was great in that.
Iana movie.
He had this total presence about him.
Did a lot of stuff. Sam Shepard, the playwright, and I believe the writer of Paris, Texas, who helped Harry Dean Stanton. Do I have that right?
I don't know.
I think Sam Shepard wrote that screenplay.
I'd like to know that.
I think that's true.
Let me check that out.
You can find that. Also a good actor.
Yeah,
yeah, very good in The Right Stuff. And
what was the one, the early one in Texas with they lived in a remote farm? And
with Jessica Lange?
Days of Heaven.
Oh, he's in Days of Heaven. Oh, the Terrence Malick movie. How could I forget that one?
Unbelievable.
Oh, my God, he's great in that.
Oh, he's unbelievable.
I love
that
film.
Yeah.
How could I forget? I'm kicking myself.
Yeah.
Rance Howard, Clint's father, passed away. Ron Howard, the patriarch of the Howard family. Someone sent me some wonderful color footage, I guess it's 16mm footage, backstage home movies of the Andy Griffith show. I'll share them with you. I put them on Facebook. And you see Rance Howard throwing a football with the kids. Mm-hmm. And it's just great.
In Mayberry.
Yeah. And Jim Nabors is in there too.
Wow.
And the last name on this list, and two more names on the list. Somebody we chased was Dick Gaudier.
Yes, we wanted him.
And I went as far as sending a letter to him. I wrote to him on his website. There was no response. It went on for weeks. We don't know what happened. He passed away. And it turned out he was in assisted living.
Oh,
so I don't know that he was reading his mail. I don't know that he was able to do it.
Yeah.
We talked to Bernie Coppell about Dick. We talked to Barbara Feldon about Dick, Norman Steinberg. Jaime the Robot.
He was hysterical.
Hysterically funny actor. Robin Hood on Mel Brooks' short lived When Things Were Rotten.
Oh my God.
In the original Conrad Birdie.
Wow.
And Bye Bye Birdie.
Yes.
Wow. Yeah. And an accomplished illustrator and a cartoonist, another guy with additional talents. He was one of the first people I wrote down. His name is still on the piece of paper hanging in my office at ABC. And it didn't work out, but we would have loved to have Dick Gaudier, who I found out had a short. He was comedy partners with Peter Marshall for a while. Did you know that?
No.
Yeah, so we could have asked Peter about him.
So he was in two comedy teams, Peter Marshall.
Yeah. I think he did something with Peter Marshall where they wrote together or some such thing. And the last name of character actor on my list here, and I know we're going to forget people, so
absolutely.
Post and write in and tell us who we forgot and yell at us, but Stephen First from Animal House.
Oh,
Flounder.
Yeah.
And Saint Elsewhere. And
Stephen First, he was once on some talk show where he was talking about how fat he was and he could never stop eating. And he said he was so embarrassed about it. He would go into McDonald's and he'd go, oh, let's see. He'd take out a list that he wrote and he'd go, oh, let's see. Greg wants the fish fillet. And Mark wants the Whopper, and
he'd make it seem like other people.
He would make it like he was getting it
thing.
For a party.
Poor thing. He died young, 63.
Yeah.
Funny guy. And was in one of the Animal House spinoffs, I guess Delta House
it was called. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Very funny guy. I ended with him for a reason, because Tim Matheson tweeted when Stephen First passed, and I thought this was so sweet. He wrote, Flounder, you fucked up. You trusted us.
Oh, wow.
Rest in peace, which I thought was just so perfect. Some of these people we lost way too young, like Stephen First and Miguel Ferrer. And also Erin Moran from Happy Days and Joni Loves John. She had a lot of problems.
Yeah.
The poor thing. So we'll move on from character actors, and let's talk quickly, and we'll try to get through everybody. Let's talk about directors. Four names I wrote down. And again, we can't get to everybody in time, but we're going to try. Somebody Gilbert lunched with, Toby Hooper.
Toby Hooper. I met him out in L.A., and I'm a big fan of the movie Life Force.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you are.
Because there's an actress in it named Matilda May, who's a female space vampire, and she walks around naked in all of her scenes, she's totally naked. And I was telling him over dinner how hot I thought she was. And he said, and he invited me over to his house. He had a big screen
there. What a story.
And he put on Life Force.
I love that. I wrote Gil Lunch in parentheses on my notes.
And he told me that Matilda May had to shave her bush for the movie.
That is so sweet.
She got ingrown hairs that were causing her a lot of problems.
Oh, my God. Once again, and this is the kind of tribute you will not see on TCM.
Yes, no, that's right.
You will not see Ben Mankiewicz.
She was sucking the life force out of various Londoners.
Yes. Well, oh, yeah. We did a whole episode about life force.
The life force. That's what that's called. That's what that is.
It's not a subtle.
Of course, the thing that made him famous was the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Oh, yeah.
And Leatherface, based on Ed Gein, the serial
real
killer.
Life. Yeah.
Yeah. He was a professor like Wes Craven before he made it big.
I didn't realize he directed Poltergeist.
Poltergeist, too, with our pal James Caron.
Poltergeist is one of those weird ones where I think it was kind of like how The Thing had the one director who's listed.
Yeah.
I think it was Christian Nyby.
Yeah.
But everyone says Howard Hawks. Yes.
Spielberg. They said Spielberg came in. It was his story, and he produced it. But he said at the time, and has said it over the years that Tobe Hooper was a perfect combination. Of their talents. Friend of McGarris's, our guest McGarris. Tributes poured in for Tobe Hooper from John Carpenter and Stephen King.
After I left Tobe Hooper's house, I went back to my hotel and jerked off.
That's a beautiful, beautiful coda.
What a tribute. What a tribute that is.
I hope wherever Tobe Hooper is. I cannot add to that except to say that he was apparently a very warm and gracious guy and a lot of people
very
liked him.
Very nice when I met him.
A lot of people liked him. Salem's Lot miniseries, too, worth seeing. Along those lines, another master of horror, George Romero.
Passed
away at 77, an icon.
Titan. Yep.
Yeah, a real titan. Another guy who made his bones in low-budget horror, like
$100,000.
I remember I put up a tweet when he died, and I said, someone call the police, George Romero is eating my leg.
I like that.
And George Romero, you know, if you're part of this whole Living Dead industry, he's the creator. It all goes back.
Oh, yeah, the father of the zombie movie.
The Walking Dead. Yeah, I mean, absolutely. All these things, there's like zombies all over the TV.
Night of the Living Dead started it all.
50th year anniversary,
by
the way.
One of the things 68. I always thought was great about that is the damn zombies could barely walk.
Yes.
And it should have been easy to run away from everybody, but it kept building and building, you know, to the point where...
And I remember I saw that with my sister Arlene when the theater used to be the Waverly Theater.
Of course, on 23rd Street.
And they were having midnight showings of that.
It's still there, but it's not a movie theater.
Is that on the east side?
Yeah.
East 23rd.
And we went there, and at first it was standing room, and then we found two seats. And that was, like, so different.
$114,000 he made that movie for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The other thing, I always wondered about Dwayne Jones, the black guy.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd say, what's that about? But actually, according to some of the stuff I read in the research, a lot of people kind of dismissed it or didn't give it much thought, but he gave it a lot of thought.
Well, he did because he saw those zombie movies as allegories.
That's right.
He was, exactly, Dawn of the Dead, he was making a commentary about consumerism.
Right.
Blind consumerism.
And Dawn of the Dead, it's like, It's one of those cases where, like, the sequel, we talked about this, where the sequel's even better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's fun. Yeah.
Because it's a combination of horror and comedy.
There's more fun in Dawn of the Dead. Yeah. But even the original film, I think that there were themes about Vietnam and violence that he was playing with. Mm-hmm. Because he said he didn't like torture porn because there was no context. There was no undercurrent for it.
Right.
There was no... So he had a lot on his mind. Yeah. They weren't mindless horror films.
Yeah.
He died at home while listening to the score from his favorite movie, A Quiet Man.
Oh, wow.
Which is sweet. Apparently, that's how Gilbert's going to go watching Matilda May.
Yes, that's right.
Shave her bush quietly, and then it'll appear in the New York Times.
And we've lost famous character actor Shaver Bush.
I loved him in The Last Picture Show. Shaver Bush. Well, yeah, from Texas, right? From the Lone Star State.
He was in a band before.
Here's a director of one of your favorite movies, Save the Tiger. John Avildsen died at 81. Also, more famous for directing Rocky and the Karate Kid series and a movie called Joe with Peter Boyle. Very controversial movie. John Avildsen, they called him the king of the underdogs. In fact, there was a documentary made about him.
Did he do just the first Rocky or did he do
something? The first Rocky, he and Stallone stayed friendly, and then he did Rocky V. But Stallone said when he passed away, I owe everything to this guy.
Yeah.
Replaced on both Saturday Night Fever and Serpico, two films he was going to direct. But he had a nice body of work. Do you remember a movie called The Stoolie with Jackie Mason?
Yes.
I don't know this picture.
Very peculiar film. It was based on a true story about this small-time hood who he was a stool pigeon.
I'll track that down.
Yeah.
I always liked Joe. John Avildsen. The documentary is very good, by the way, King of the Underdogs. I don't think there was a mention of The Stoolie in there. Jonathan Demme died, one of my favorites.
Oh, yeah.
Interesting reading, an obit in Variety, and they said that he was almost defined by his lack of a signature because his films were so different.
Yeah.
I mean, Melvin and Howard, which is a movie I love with Jason Robards. Something Wild. You know that picture?
Oh, yeah.
Melanie Griffith and Jeff Daniels and Ray Liotta as the heavy. Born on Long Island, started with Corman. He was a Corman guy, Corman guy.
It's always amazing who came out of the Corman film.
Oh, so many people. Bogdanovich and
that'd be a good show, right?
Joe Dante. Well, we had Bogdanovich and Joe Dante, who were both graduates. And to a lesser extent Clint Howard, who was in all of those Corman things. He had a bad experience making a studio film called Swing Shift with Goldie Hawn, and then decided from that point on he was going to make movies his own way, and did everything. He did political documentaries, the Talking Heads movie, Stop Making Sense, which is a masterpiece, really. He made a movie with Spalding Gray, a film version of Swimming to Cambodia.
Right.
Beloved guy. Everybody had nice things to say about him. See those movies. See Melvin and Howard if you can, if you haven't seen it. Of course, Silence of the Lambs people know.
Oh, yeah.
That was the thing that suddenly gave him a big breakthrough. He was able to make anything he wanted. But see one of his last films, Rachel Getting Married. Very good.
That's a great movie.
Terrific picture written by Sidney Lumet's daughter.
Lumet. Who's the lead in that?
Her name just went out of my head. Anne Hathaway.
Anne Hathaway.
Terrific picture. See Something Wild and Melvin and Howard and his first film called Handle with Care. A real artist. And I like Married to the Mob, too, which has a fun performance by Dean Stockwell and a fun performance from Alec Baldwin. He really could do anything. And those Corman guys amounted to a lot.
Oh, yeah. They just showed up. They were not bullshit. They knew how to make a movie
on a budget. Let's do a couple of TV icons here. Two people from an iconic show, Mary Tyler Moore and Rosemary.
Rosemary.
We just lost Rosemary.
We were trying for.
Boy, oh boy, did we. And I posted that on Facebook, and we did everything in our power on that one.
Yeah, we desperately wanted Rosemary.
And our pal, Harlan Bowl, who brought us Charlotte Ray and brought us Tippi Hedren and so many people, was helping and was trying to make it happen. I don't know if it was a matter of she didn't want to do an hour show. Yeah. She was on Oxygen. Maybe she wasn't up for it.
I think her health wasn't.
It took a turn for the worse, and we couldn't make it happen. But God, that was another back and forth, like Bill Dana.
And she was like, I mean, she knew all these big time mobsters like Benzie.
She knew Bugsy Siegel. I think she knew Capone.
Not movie mobsters, but real mobsters.
Real mobsters. She was a kid in vaudeville. Yeah, she compared. The story goes that she complained about her paycheck to Bugsy Siegel.
Oh my!
She was baby Rosemary.
Who signed that check, darling?
She did Doug Benson's podcast. I think a lot of that stuff came up with Doug. So maybe you guys can find that one because we didn't get her. She was a child star. She was baby Rosemary. She was a singing star at age 5. I mean, this stuff we would have eaten up, and we tried. She worked with W.C. Fields, for Christ's sake. She worked with Burns and Allen, Rosemary Mazzetta, and from New York, of course. I found this interesting, and I never knew this about her, God bless her. She was cut from the Phil Silvers movie Top Banana because she publicly refused the producer sexual advances.
Whoa. Ooh,
how about that for
timely?
Back then.
Holy, and when? Wow. So when was that?
Back then. I'm going to say it was in the 40s.
Wow.
I don't have a. You can look up the time. You can look up the date on the movie.
What was the Top Banana?
It was a Phil Silvers movie. The producer was making overtures, not Phil Silvers.
Yeah.
not Bilko.
Let's be careful.
but I want to say too what I read some. Women writers and comedians were posting all over Facebook how Sally Rogers, how her character on the Van Dyke Show inspired them to go into comedy. And that was just sweet.
Yeah.
She was something else. And Gino, our pal Gino Salamone, had lunch with her, has great stories. Maybe we'll bring Gino on with his Rosemary stories. But God damn it, we tried.
Yeah.
And we are the poorer for not having her. And
Top Banana was 1954.
54. I'm way the hell off.
Yeah.
Still,
that's a long time before now when all this is coming out.
And her co-star, we won't talk a long time about Mary Tyler Moore because we did a tribute episode about her with Bill Persky. Bill loved her to death. We've said this before, and I'll say it again. She just doesn't get enough credit for being a straight man surrounded by funny people.
Oh yes,
and setting them up. And she was funny in her own right. But she let Asner shine, and she let Cloris Leachman shine. Right. And a lot of actresses wouldn't have allowed some other women to be funnier than her, or Valerie Harper, who was getting the laugh lines in those early seasons, and Ted Knight, and Sue Ann Nivens. She was generous, and she was smart because she knew. I think Billy said this. She knew that. That was going to make her successful.
And let
people shine.
It's kind of like, I remember there was an interview, they asked Jack Benny, like, how do you feel about Mel Blanc and
Rochester?
Rochester, right. Don Wilson, Dennis Day.
And his wife?
Yeah.
Everybody's getting the laughs.
All stealing the show from you.
Right.
And Benny said, I want them to steal the show from me. Because the next day, everyone will be talking about how funny the Jack Benny show was.
Yeah, I wonder if I don't know if she ever cited that personally, or that's what she was inspired by or modeling herself after. But if you look at that show and the Van Dyke show too,
she has to play
straight,
a lot
to funny people and like Reiner himself. So Billy helped her, and he was modest about it, but he and his late partner, Sam Denoff, brought her back. After the Van Dyke show was gone, she opened in Breakfast at Tiffany's on Broadway.
I was going to say.
You have that?
Well, I have some. Yeah, because Mary Tyler Moore can do no wrong, I thought we should have one, just to bring the show down.
Yeah.
One negative anecdote.
She was floundering.
She was cast with Richard Chamberlain.
Correct.
They called it Holly Go Lightly, produced by David Merrick.
Correct.
Right, who closed the show after 4 previews a week before it was supposed to open out of consideration for the audience.
Yeah.
Ooh.
And she was, and the nature of this business, she was suddenly ice cold.
Unbelievable.
And Bill,
December 1996.
That is correct. Yeah. And that Elvis movie where she played the nun also didn't help.
Yeah.
Didn't do very well. Bill and Sam wrote a comeback vehicle for her called Dick Van Dyke and the Other Woman. A CBS special, which was terrific and got great ratings, and it led to CBS's interest in having her come in. And it led to them indirectly to the Mary Tyler Moore show.
Wow.
And she's great in dramatic roles. She's great in Ordinary People.
Yes.
And,
oh, God, Ordinary People. That was amazing.
Terrific. And a movie with Robert Preston called Finnegan Begin Again. I don't know if you guys know this movie. See it. It was an HBO movie.
Yeah.
And it's brilliant. And they're both brilliant in it. And I'd also like to point out that she raised a lot of money for charity and particularly for children. And was a great New Yorker. As far as I was concerned,
Ordinary People was a shocker.
Great
that
in that.
She could play that kind of character so well.
Never bad in anything. Fun fun in a movie called Flirting with Disaster, where she and George Segal play Ben Stiller's parents. So, terrific in comedy. So there's a couple of icons. Another TV icon of that era, Jim Nabors.
Oh, yeah.
And Gilbert paid tribute in his own way recently to Jim Nabors on the show.
We don't have to go through that again.
We don't have to go through that again. Let me see if the timing of this. Okay, so they've already heard that one by the time they're hearing this. This is the 15th that this is running. But here's some trivia. One of his first breaks, one of the first people to discover Jim Nabors and put him on television was, drumroll, Bill Dana.
Wow.
Jim Nabors was born in Alabama, Salicauga. I don't even know how to pronounce this place. Our listeners in Alabama will get on my ass. Salicauga, Alabama, moved to New York. He was working as a typist at the UN. Very strange. And he was doing cabaret. And he was doing cabaret in a club called The Horn.
He was in a band, too. Sort of. I mean, in the cabaret performance.
There you go. Bill Dana saw him. I got this story wrong. He'd moved to L.A. He was doing cabaret in New York, but he moved to L.A. That's where The Horn was on Santa Monica or in Santa Monica. Bill Dana saw him, put him on the Steve Allen show. How about that?
Wow.
And not much came of that, but then Andy Griffith saw him in the same goddamn club and the rest is history. And he was supposed to do one part on the Griffith show. But he was so good. He's supposed to do one episode as Goober's cousin.
And most of us remember him for saying, "You're gonna fuck Dolly Parton and then fuck me up the ass."
Was that a catchphrase that I didn't know about?
Yeah, that's why Andy
they had
Griffith
lunch boxes.
Really? This is sick. I think I misspoke. I think Goober came later after Gomer. I'll just chew anything I can to change the subject.
Goober came later.
Yeah.
Yes, that was the autobiography of Jim Nabors.
This is going to be a running joke
worse,
now.
Frank,
we cannot eulogize Jim Nabors. Okay,
Goober
I got it.
Came later.
Okay. Okay.
And Floyd came right away.
Okay.
Okay.
Here's. Oh, that's going to turn up in your act. As long as we're talking about TV icons.
Okay.
You know, I was thinking, I was doing the notes on this, and I thought it'd be fun if we had people who remembered these people to come on the show and talk about it, like Ronnie Schell to talk about Jim Nabors and Burt Ward to talk about Adam West, who passed. But we don't have the time.
No.
Because each one of those would be another episode. You can't have somebody come on for 3 minutes and get off the line. Here's an icon, June Foray.
Oh, my God.
99, the first lady of voice acting.
I would have loved to have spoken to her.
We blew that one.
So she was Natasha.
She was Natasha and on Bullwinkle, as we established.
She was everything.
She was everything. She was
Rocky.
She was.
Also,
she was Rocky. Yes, it's important to point that out. She was also Talking Tina in that famous Twilight Zone episode.
Oh, wow.
How about that shit?
Awesome.
Yeah.
That's a great one.
She was great.
She was Cindy Lou Who.
The sci-fi just played that Twilight Zone episode.
Oh, with Telly Savalas with hair.
The marathon.
Yeah.
Anyway, Cindy Lou. Yeah,
she was Cindy Lou Who in The Grinch. She was Witch Hazel for Chuck Jones on Bugs Bunny. She was Nell on Dudley Do-Right. Oh, and a million other things. And she did comedy albums with Dawes Butler and Stan Freberg. And she worked with Chuck Jones, as I said, and Tex Avery and Walter Lantz. And she worked with everything. She did everything. And I even had the pleasure of writing for her when I wrote a couple of the Sylvester and Tweety mysteries later in her career in the 90s. And that was a thrill.
She had an 85-year career.
career.
She was
insane.
You know, and I look at this and I say, you schmucks, she was 99 and we never got her.
Yes.
Yeah. And the other trivia point here, at 94, she became the oldest person to what?
Parasail?
Win. Goober came later.
Bungee jump?
Win an Emmy. The oldest person to win an Emmy.
Is that true?
At 94 for Mrs. Cauldron
God
on the
damn
Garfield
it, that's
show.
That's cool.
Wow.
Yeah, right. Well, our friend Mark Evanier.
Yeah, ridiculously talented.
She was close to Mark, and I think Mark put her memorial service together. And close with Leonard Maltin. She was even friends with guests that we've had on
yes,
the show.
Yes.
And we didn't connect the dots. I don't know why we didn't call June Foray.
Yeah,
but
that's one of those horrible.
We won't make this a show about regrets.
Or that would have to be a whole other
yes.
series.
Why don't we do a whole episode about how we fucked up?
Yeah.
Here's a guy, Monty Hall.
Oh,
Monty
yeah.
Monty Hall.
Monty Hall, an Orthodox Jew. Gilbert, you would have
yes.
loved that. Also Canadian,
wow.
from Winnipeg. Monty Halperin was his name. I don't know how it got shortened to Monty Hall, but not only a game show host, not only obviously the host of Let's Make a Deal, he was a philanthropist, which I didn't know. He raised $1 billion in charity in his lifetime.
$1 billion.
Can you imagine that?
Wow.
At least what I found
about
him.
Yeah.
Also produced game shows like Masquerade Party, Split Second. And also in a memorable Odd Couple episode where Felix and Oscar go on Let's Make a Deal. Funny guy, a versatile guy, did different things. And while we're on the subject of both game shows and kicking ourselves for guests we didn't get, see if you know where I'm going here, Gil. We had the Practical Jokers here.
Yes.
And they told us, please, 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 if you get this guy on the show, let us sit in. And he was on our list.
Yeah.
But I think difficult to get.
Oh.
And I hit wall after wall because he was a recluse, Chuck Barris.
Oh, yeah.
Mm.
That would have been one of the reasons to do this show, was to get Chuck Barris. And when you do a show like this and you sit down and you design this show and you figure it out, you think, okay, who's going to be fun? Who's got stories? Who's the raconteur? Right. Who's the character? Chuck Barris.
Chuck Barris would have been one of those great shows where every story you go, is that true?
Well, it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Yes, we lost game show impresario and CIA hitman Chuck Barris. From Philly, a renaissance man. He wrote Palisades Park for Freddie Boom Boom Cannon. He wrote hit songs.
What is this whole music connection we're discovering?
I don't know.
They
called him the Baron of Bad Taste.
Chuck Barris on the Gong Show, whenever there was a dog act there, like, he would fill the crotch of his pants.
That's correct.
With cold cuts. So
well, that's an old trick from
would start running over and sticking his nose in his crotch, and he'd be going, "Hey, what's going on here? Stop! Hey, stop it!"
Your Chuck Barris sounds a little bit like your Floyd the Barber. He was nicknamed the Ayatollah of Trasherola, the Baron of Bad Taste, the Sultan of, what did I write here? The Sultan of Schlock, the Dating Game, the Newlywed Game, How's Your Mother-in-Law, hosted by our former guest Wink Martindale, the $1.98 Beauty Contest, hosted by Rip Taylor. Oh, goddamn, he was one of a kind. His daughter died, and he, from people I know that knew him, told me that his daughter died and he was never the same.
Oh.
And retreated from the public eye. So I don't know that we would have gotten him.
Yeah.
But the day that I found out that he passed, you know, these little things flash up on my screen. And, you know, and I each one of is like a knife in my gut when we didn't get them. So running out of time, I think we should do comedians. Does that make sense?
Comedians never die.
We lost two giants this year, but we did tribute episodes to them, and that's Jerry Lewis and Don Rickles.
Yes.
So in the interest of time, I will direct people to those episodes. We talked about Jerry a lot on the show, but we did a 90th birthday show about Jerry.
Oh, yeah.
And we did a Rickles tribute that Frank Verderosa made some lovely additions to, Some beautiful touches on that one. But we're going to talk about three guys lesser known than Rickles and Jerry Lewis. One guy, and I guess it's okay to say now, was our first guest on this podcast.
Oh, yeah.
Ever.
Yes.
And it became a mystery because we didn't want to say it while he was alive, and we didn't want to embarrass.
Yeah, that's one we've never broadcast.
We never put it out, and that was the professor, the foremost authority. It's hardly a secret anymore because I've told 40 people on social media, but he was the first person we sat down to talk to in his apartment.
Yeah, we interviewed him at his apartment, and afterwards we went to have some pizza.
In the pizza store.
Yeah, in the pizza store. And I remember thinking and talking, saying, okay, you know, we tried a podcast.
It was a disaster.
It was an attempt.
Couldn't get the conversation rolling.
He was 100 at the time. I think he passed at 102.
Yeah, he went from being funny mixed up to just mixed up.
Yeah. It wasn't, and God bless him. I mean, he was there. We came in, his son set it up, and brought us into his apartment. He was in an apartment forever down in the Lower East Side.
He probably paid 10 cents a month.
Yeah. but and he was game, and he was sweet, and he was nice, and we told stories. But it really wasn't. And in his defense, and to be fair, you and I really didn't have any kind of mojo either. We didn't know what we were doing. We set up the equipment on his coffee table. We couldn't see each other, so there was no way for Gilbert and I to react. We had no idea what we were doing.
It was very awkward. I remember both of us turning our heads to the side to look at him because we were sitting on a couch.
It wasn't wasn't to be. And then Darren and I had a talk, and we said, is this going to work? And I said, why don't we get a guest who's an automatic, who does the work for us?
So who was episode number two?
Dick Cavett.
Dick Cavett.
Because I'm not stupid.
Dick Cavett.
I'm a lot of things, but I'm not stupid.
Cavett's one of those click on the microphone.
Yeah, we got Dick to come over. Gilbert poured some wine. Dara poured out some wine, put out some wine and cheese, and he sat down, and bam, we had a podcast.
So this is a major reveal on the podcast.
Yes. Well, we didn't want to embarrass the man.
First guest.
In case he was chasing work at 100. But I find, of course, all these wonderful things about him. I mean, he was a union organizer. Maybe he's a radical lefty.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, practically a communist if he wasn't a communist.
Close friends with Lenny Bruce.
Close friends with Thomas Pinchon, for Christ's sake.
Nobody's close friends with
him. He accepted a National Book Award for Thomas Pynchon.
Really?
And people thought he was Thomas Pynchon because Thomas Pynchon was a recluse and they didn't know what he looked like. Born in the clubs. I mean, the character, the foremost authority, the Hungry Eye and the Playboy Club.
Where did he
radio with Edgar Bergen, for Christ's sake.
Was he an Ed Sullivan guest?
I don't know. I know that he's in a movie with Hope and Gleason called How to Commit Marriage.
Oh, geez.
You know this picture?
Yeah.
He's in Car Wash with Richard Pryor and George Carlin. In his later years, he used to solicit donations from drivers for children in the third world.
Cars.
Yeah.
You mean like those guys that sell things on Veterans Day and stuff?
Yeah, you could research this. It's online. It's in his Times Obit.
Homeless man.
Yeah.
So weird.
Yeah, he would stand outside the Midtown Tunnel and ask you to roll down your window, and he'd have a bucket for orphans, for children in the third world, and he'd collect money and send them the money. He was a person of conscience. Interesting man and almost our first guest. Anyway, here's two guys we never got. Shelley Berman.
Oh,
yeah. Lost Shelley Berman. He was sick almost from the moment that we started the show.
Yeah, Shelley Berman would have been a great one.
He was not in good condition.
Yeah.
But when was he on Curb Your Enthusiasm? Because he looked
before they shut that show down a couple of years ago. We started the podcast in 2014, and we heard he was already starting to fade, unfortunately. Very brilliant guy. Did a play with Gino Conforti, who we just had on the show.
Wow.
The famous Twilight episode where everybody looks like him.
Everyone has his face.
Yeah.
And he had that brilliant routine talking about how he's on the phone with his father.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, wonderful. It was funny. And
a monologist.
Touching.
Back when somebody could sit down and do a bit and hold an audience with just a stool and do an hour and a half. And he was a compass player, which was the predecessor of the precursor of Second City in Chicago. And
I remember he has one where he's like a guy on the phone talking to a girl that he just went on a date with the night before. And she, you know, obviously didn't do well. And one of his lines is, yeah, well, but when a man and woman are holding hands, how do you know which hand is the sweaty one?
Funny guy. Funny guy. See if you can find, I was talking to our fans, Shelley Berman's routines online.
And I met him twice.
You did?
Yeah.
Do
yeah.
tell.
He was one time.
But you shared a publicist. Glenn was his publicist.
I was in, I think, San Francisco. He was putting on a show, and it was actually about Jewish comics.
I love it.
And he was in charge of it, and he very nice man. And then I ran into him later, which I would love. I don't know if someone recorded this. I was in Vegas, and Larry King had on stage with him.
Wow.
What he called the Founders of Vegas. And he had Shelley Berman, Jerry Lewis.
Was Shecky there?
Yeah, Shecky was there. I think maybe Phyllis Diller was
there.
Wow,
what a show.
Oh, yeah, it was an amazing. Oh, and George Carlin.
Wow, what I wouldn't have given.
Yeah.
I worked with Phyllis Diller. Did you work with her?
I worked with her.
She was a treat.
She was one of those, she was like.
I loved her.
100 and walked around without a cane.
I loved her. I had a great experience with her that I'll tell sometime on the show. He was nominated for an Emmy for that role at Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Oh, was he really?
Yeah.
He was great.
And I found this touching. Fred Willard wrote this on Facebook. I am outraged that the great, the legendary, the hilarious Shelley Berman has not been mentioned in any of the end-of-year memorial tributes.
Wow.
If you don't remember him, Google him. Please Google him. He was perhaps the greatest of his time.
Wow.
Shelley Berman should not be forgotten.
So his peak would have been what, 50s or?
I want to say late 50s, 60s.
Yeah. Or
Shelley
60s.
Berman?
I guess so, yeah.
Yeah, mid 50s to late 50s. I'm not entirely sure. I remember him. I remember him as an actor. He was in a lot of stuff, too.
Oh,
He's in a Mary Tyler Moore episode with Gino Conforti.
Oh, my God.
Who we just talked to.
And they always cast him as like a very prissy
yes.
guy.
Well, he did that yeah. well.
Yeah.
He did it well. Here's one more name from the same era and the Playboy clubs. All of these guys were contemporaries, the three guys that I'm mentioning here. Dick Gregory.
Oh, yeah.
Hmm. A friend of Ed Weinberger, another guy that we could have had come and talk about Dick. If we could do a 7-hour
exactly.
in memoriam, we would have all these people call up and talk about
and
them.
I remember I met Dick Gregory at the Hugh Hefner roast because he was like indebted to Hugh Hefner.
Oh, absolutely.
For cast,
the Playboy
hiring
clubs.
Hiring him.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, he segregated. He integrated those clubs.
Yeah.
He was instrumental in Dick Gregory's success. Born in St. Louis, raised by his mom, moved to Chicago to become a comedian. And we got that great story when Patty Farmer was here about how he used to prepare to be heckled.
Oh, wow.
He used to tell his wife, while she was ironing his clothes, his shirts to go on, he would tell his wife, instruct his wife, yell the nastiest epithets at me that you can because he wanted to steel himself.
Yeah.
Imagine that.
Yeah.
The great Dick Gregory did a lot with his life. Hefner, by the way, since you're bringing up Hefner, we also lost Hefner.
Yes.
This year. I didn't put him on the list because I don't really think of him as an entertainment person.
But boy, he was so important in the entertainment.
But he was important in the entertainment industry. This is an interesting thing about Dick Gregory. He refused to appear on the Jack Parr Show unless he could sit and talk with Parr, and that wasn't done either at the time.
Wow.
They did not. If they had a black act on the show, he did not then sit down and interact.
Wow.
With the host, and he insisted that he do that. Also very active in the civil rights movement, and he unsuccessfully ran for president in 1968. He became a assassination conspiracy theorist. He wrote a million books. Very, very interesting man. I
he
met
got
him too.
Involved in healthy diets. And
he did. He was a vegetarian just a very, very interesting man. A man of many talents and many interests. and I had the pleasure of meeting him.
I found online in the research, somebody, I don't know who this was, but this could actually apply to a lot of the people we're talking about, is just when Dick Gregory died, he said, heaven just got funnier.
Oh, yeah. They say that a lot about it. They won't say it when Gilbert's gone. They'll say heaven just got louder. Heaven got noisier.
Heaven just got Jewier.
I love it.
Calls to mind your Jewy spice.
Love it. Always tops me. Always tops me. I want to mention three friends real quickly as we wind down. My friend Jay Lynch died, and some of the people listening to this show will know Jay Lynch. I get a lot of questions about when I wrote Bazooka Joe comics, and I wrote for Tops, and Gilbert knows this. I used to write Garbage Pail Kids, and I used to write Wacky Packs. I have them on my wall at work. It was one of my first. My friend Mark Newgarden, who I went to the School of Visual Arts with, brought me in there generously, my late friend Russ Riley. I got to know Jay, who was an underground cartoonist and a legend and had been doing Wacky Packs, and I think had been writing Bazooka Joes since the 50s or the 60s or however the hell old they were. A real interesting guy, a genuine character. He worked for Mad, too. You're a Mad fan.
Oh, yes.
Look him up. Look up his work. Underground comics called Bijou Funnies, which he also edited. There's a great comics journal interview with him. He was one of us.
Yeah.
He was a fan of weird show business and weird arcane stuff and could do references like us, make these kind of obscure references. A sweet guy. I spent quality time with him. I wish I knew him better. Jay Lynch. Len Wein, I have to mention. Len passed at 69, a mutual friend of mine and Mark Evaneers. I've mentioned him, too, on the show. He was a comic book giant. He created Swamp Thing. He created Wolverine.
Yeah.
He created the character of Storm from the X-Men. A lovely man who helped me in Los Angeles when I didn't know anybody, when I had nowhere to go for the holidays, took me in. A funny guy. Again, one of us. I mean, could top us.
Yeah.
Could tell you who the 10th actor was, who was Fritz Feld's stand-in. He knew radio.
There's another one like you guys.
Oh, Len Wein, you guys would have loved him. He introduced me to Harlan Ellison, which was a life-changing experience. I had Thanksgiving dinner at Len's house. His beautiful wife, Christine, took me in. I was living in L.A. with nowhere to go for Thanksgiving. He was one of those guys that just knowing him made me feel legitimate.
Oh, wow.
You know, it made me feel like I was funny, and I was one of the crowd. He had me to a poker game at his house. I didn't play poker. You know David Mandel, who wrote for Seinfeld and Curb?
Yeah,
you must know David.
Yes.
David was winning at poker. I didn't know how the hell to play, but the fact that they invited me, I was thrilled to be there. Marv Wolfman was there, too, another great comic book guru. I love talking to him. I love knowing him. He was just a wonderful guy. And I had the honor of introducing him to Whoopi, and they were both thrilled. And I think Whoopi was more thrilled to meet him. So we lost Len at 69.
A lot of the obits mentioned Wolverine, which is huge with the kids now. My kids are all over Wolverine.
Well, Hugh Jackman tweeted when Len died, I owed this man my career.
Yeah, that's great.
So,
yeah.
Which is, you know, maybe that was a little bit of hyperbole, but also Jack Mendelsohn. I'll get through this quick. We have a special name at the end. Jack Mendelsohn was a Renaissance man, another Brooklyn boy, Gilbert. You would have loved Jack. He would have loved you. He was a Jew.
You'd never tell by the name.
You could tell by the name.
Yeah.
Jack, among his other credentials and other cool things that he did, wrote Yellow Submarine. He wrote a Beatle movie.
Oh,
I mean, the Beatles weren't in it. But it's still pretty cool.
Yeah.
A cool goddamn thing to have done. He was a cartoonist. He had a strip called Jackie's Diary, G-A-C-K-Y-S. See if you can find it. It was a Sunday-only strip that they ran from 1959 to 61. You're going to love these credits. He was a comic book guy. He was a cartoonist. He started writing for Hanna-Barbera. He wrote cartoons for Paramount. He wrote the Abbott and Costello animated show.
Oh, my God.
The one Bud Abbott voiced. He wrote... Will the real Jerry Lewis please sit down?
Wow.
Remember that cartoon show with David Lander? Drew's a fan of that. He wrote Flintstones. He wrote Scooby-Doo. He went on to write live action. He wrote Laugh-In. He wrote Love Boat. He wrote Dick Van Dyke's variety show, Van Dyke and Company. I overuse the term Renaissance man, but he was. And quickly, I was, again, floundering in Los Angeles, and I didn't know anybody, and I was holed up in a hotel room on Ventura Boulevard, and I was... I only had 2 days left in L.A. that I could afford before I had to go back to New York. And I was determined to make something happen. I made a bunch of phone calls, and I called my friends at Mad Magazine, and I said, is there anybody here in L.A. that I could meet or will meet me or have lunch with me or talk to me or read my scripts? And Nick Meglin, did you know Nick, an editor at Mad? Nick was John Ficarra's partner at Mad.
I probably have met him.
He answered the phone at Mad, and he said, oh, you got to call Jack Mendelsohn. I said, you know Jack Mendelsohn? He said, yeah, he lives in Sherman Oaks. He lives 10 blocks from where you're staying. I called Jack. A guy whose work I had revered on the Carol Burnett Show and laughing. He comes to the phone. He says, well, what are you doing now? I went to lunch with him. He said, give me your script. I gave him my script. He read it, and he called me that night. And he said, you should be working. He said, you got to move here. And my life changed. I moved to L.A. I got an agent, and I got legit.
Yeah.
Quickly, because of Jack Mendelsohn, and he got me work.
Yeah.
And I wrote cartoons because an agent called me 48 hours later and said Jack doesn't like anybody, so it's praise from Caesar. So we want to sign you, and I signed with an agency, and I started to work, and that led to writing Saturday morning cartoons, and I got to meet June Foray, yeah. And write for her, and I wrote a cartoon show for Spielberg, and it all came from Jack. I'd lost touch with him, and I called him. 2 years ago, I called him up and I thanked him, and I'm glad I did. So, last but not least.
Oh, yeah. My sister Arlene Gottfried, she was a photographer. You'd have to look her up on the internet. And look at her books and the photos. She loved the old New York, you know, the decrepit, decaying New York.
She sure did.
And you'd see these people like, you know, junkies or just pathetic people. But her photos were never critical of them. She never looked down on those people. And one time she was... taking photos of a gospel group, and she loved them so much she became a Pentecostal gospel singer.
Isn't that hilarious?
And my mother started to call her the singing photographer.
I love that.
And she, the whole Spanish culture.
Well, like, she captured New York as it was.
Yes,
she captured it. She captured a whole different New York that will never come again.
It's a really interesting point that you make, that she didn't judge these.
No, yeah.
and you
quite
see
the opposite.
The real wistful side of New
affection,
York.
The affection is in the pictures.
The strangest people, and it was never looking down on them.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I think it's fair to say she steals your documentary.
Oh, yes, she does.
And Neil has been here and told us himself that that was a pleasant surprise. Is there a Kleenex over there?
Oh,
I'll
yeah,
grab one.
Yes.
That Neil had no idea when he took you on. That he was going to get the bonus, the extra special bonus of Arlene.
That, I mean, if there's one reason I'm happy for doing that documentary, is that Arlene got her time in the sun.
And everybody discovered her.
Yeah.
You know, and everybody said, where, you know, people knew. I mean, people knew, people in the gospel group knew about her, people... People in photography certainly knew who she was.
Yeah.
And she had said a couple of times, she said, they'll notice me when I'm dead. And sure enough, when she died, there was a beautiful obit in the New York Times.
Beautiful. I urge people to,
find it. She lived in the neighborhood. You saw her every day.
Yeah.
A very sweet person, may I say. Very, very sweet. Much kinder than you. Much nicer.
You got to wonder how they're related.
Oh, my God. I ever meet somebody and go, this is your sibling? How is that possible? Separated at birth, left on the doorstep, lovely, and everything you're not. Engaging and real and authentic and kind and ask you about yourself.
Yes, a human being.
A human being in the most flattering and admirable sense of the word. I loved her the minute I met her, and just affection, and she treated me like a member of the family. And
she was here with us in the studio when we watched the documentary for the first time.
Yes, she was.
I was so happy yeah. that she lived to see the documentary. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I'm going to tell people to find Arlene's books. They are on Amazon, Midnight, Eternal Light. There's a great one called Sometimes Overwhelming. You can even find her singing.
Oh, yes.
Online, on YouTube.
One of the great New York photographers, no question.
And one of the great New York photographers.
At her funeral, we had a group of gospel singers and people from the Black Church who loved her.
It was a great, I have to say, you know, if a wake, if a service can be, what, an uplifting event, it was.
Yeah.
It was a celebration of a life. I think she would have appreciated. I know that's a cliche.
Yeah, one of them said, like, how original and different she was. And he said, how else do you explain how a Jewish girl from Brooklyn becomes a Pentecostal gospel singer?
And these singers, these people from her gospel group got up and sang.
Yes.
And this little
memorial.
Yeah.
Like we have a little memorial, a little chapel. And they got up, and it was, you thought you were at a revival.
It was amazing.
Yeah, look up her name on the internet.
Arlene, Arlene. Look up her books. Look up her photography. I think, you know, I was doing research for the show, and the New York Times had one long scroll where they basically had photographs and little write-ups of all of the VIPs that passed away in 2018. Yeah. I used it for research. And everybody was there, Rickles and Jerry Lewis and Chuck Berry and Mary Tyler Moore and all of these icons. And I got to the G's and there was Arlene Godfrey in that company.
Yeah.
I think she would have appreciated
it. Yeah. But so that was a personal loss.
Yes. And she was a great and deserves to be mentioned with all of these other people. And I will say that Lily also stole the movie.
Oh, yes.
Let's not leave her out. Let's give her her due.
And so, Arlene was there when my son Max was born.
Was she?
Yes.
Oh, you never told me that.
Yeah.
Yeah. You named Lily and Max after your folks.
Yeah.
A nice tribute. There are so many great moments in Neil's movie. Credit to Neil and everybody associated with making that movie. But the Arlene moments are my favorite.
And the funny thing is when Neil speaks about her, it's a lot more coherent than I am speaking about it.
Interesting.
He's so
she was a gift.
He loved her.
Yeah, she was a gift to that film.
And so many of her photographs are in it.
Everybody I give the movie to, I'm going to give it to somebody at work tomorrow. Ask me for it. Everybody I've shown the movie to or given the movie to comes back and says I had no idea. Well, you too. It's a credit to you, the way you come across. But I had no idea this was going to make me cry or be so touching. I thought I'd laugh at Gilbert's shenanigans, but I didn't think that. And she's a large part of that. And the stuff with your mom where she documented your mom's passing in photography, it's something. She was a great artist.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anywho.
Photographer. This singer, everything.
Everything. So I urge people to seek out her work. People wrote very nice things on Twitter and on Facebook when she passed. But seek out her work, which is the best way to remember these people.
And thanks to Arlene, we're able to end this show on a nice note, which we don't usually manage.
Yes.
End it with Jim Neighbors.
Anyway, we miss these people. Their time will never come again. And 2017. It's why we do this show, to remember them, the ones we get, the ones we don't get. So
I'm Gilbert Gottfried. This has been Gilbert Gottfried's Amazing Colossal Podcast with my co-host and life partner.
You say that now.
Yes. With my life mate.
You know it's legal now.
Frank Santopadre and Paul Raybone, the great jazz musician.
Thank you, Paul Raybone.
It's okay, man. Happy to be here.
Thanks for listening,
guys.
This
has been our In Memoriam, and leave us alone. There's a lot of people we left.
Yeah, fuck off. See you next time.